Hello guys, this is Olayeni Diekolola Daniels, popularly known as Dieko Spectre, and welcome to my channel. Guys, this is Olayeni Diekolola Daniels, popularly known as Dieko Spectre, and this is another episode of Dieko Talks Law. And on today's episode of Dieko Talks Law, we'll be talking about the law of succession, and I'll be talking about the Benin customary law. I'll be answering the question, what is the Igiobi? But before I go into what I have today, if this is your first time of coming to my channel, then I want to say a very big welcome. That you click the subscribe button, and also make sure that you click the notification bell so that anytime I release a video that will be of interest to you, you'll be one of the first set of people to watch that particular video. So going into what exactly we have today, we are asking and answering the question, what is the Igiobi? Do you understand? So now, before we delve into what the Igiobi is, you have to know that we are talking about the Benin customary law, and there are three customs under the Benin customary law. The first one is the Uro custom, the second one is the rule of primogeniture, while the third one is the one concerning the Igiobi. Do you understand? That is the Igiobi custom. Now, when you're talking about the Uro custom, I'm going to explain the Uro custom in another video entirely, same as the primogeniture custom. But I just want to give highlights on the primogeniture custom. Now, when you're talking about the primogeniture custom, you are saying that the eldest son in the primogeniture custom is the one that is supposed to take the properties. Do you understand? However, there are two variants of the primogeniture custom. The first variant was stated in the case of Ogiamin versus Ogiamin, or Ogiamen versus Ogiamen. Now, I am not a Benin person, so when it comes to the pronunciation, I might be wrong. So please forgive me. Now, in that particular case, the court held in that case that the eldest son is supposed to take the whole property of the deceased exclusively. Do you understand? And his brothers do not have right to that particular property. That's the first variant, when you have the eldest son holding the property exclusively. He owns it. If the man had 50 properties during his lifetime, he will be the owner of those 50 properties. Do you understand? Why the second variant is where when the deceased dies, then the eldest son is supposed to hold the property in trust, just like he's the family head, and the property does not belong to him but belongs to the family. I have made a different video entirely on family property and how the family head is supposed to hold the family property in trust for the members. Please do well to watch that video. I'll drop a link in the description below. So like I was saying, the first variant was stated in the case of Ogiamin versus Ogiamin, that the eldest son holds the property exclusively and then he becomes the owner of all the property of the deceased. The second is where the property is not owned by the eldest son but by the family, and the eldest son is only but a family head who holds the property in trust, which means that he administers the property and manages the property. And like I said earlier, we also have the Uro custom. Now, you know, in different parts of Benin Kingdom, they practice this custom, so it depends on what part of Benin Kingdom you are coming from. However, there is one particular custom that they practice in all parts of Benin Kingdom, and that is the custom of the Igiobi. Do you understand? Now, when you are talking about the Igiobi is regarded as a family house. Do you understand? Igiobi is a family house. Do you understand? Now, the thing is, when the deceased dies, the igiobe is to be inherited exclusively by the eldest son. No other person has right to inheritance of that igiobe except the eldest son. Therefore, we now have two questions. What kind of house will constitute igiobe? That's the first question. And the second question, why is it only the son that can, the eldest son that can inherit, you know, the igiobe? That is to say that why can't women also inherit igiobe, or, you know, other children or thereabouts? I'm going to be answering the second question in subsequent videos to be released, but for the first question, what constitutes igiobe, I'll be answering in this particular video. Do you understand? Now, when you are talking about the igiobe, like I said earlier, there are some things that you are supposed to know. The first thing you are supposed to know about the igiobe is that it must be owned by a Benin man. Do you understand? The igiobe must be owned by a Benin man. That is number one. Number two, the igiobe must be situated in Benin Kingdom. Do you understand? The igiobe must be situated in Benin Kingdom. And that was stated in the case of Ohagaba versus Orungahe. Now, note that, like I said earlier, I don't know the pronunciation of these cases. However, I am going to be putting them on the screen so that you would see them yourself and be able to pronounce them, because I definitely can pronounce them well. In that case, it was held that the igiobe must be situated in Benin Kingdom. The igiobe must be held by a Benin man. Do you understand? Now, another thing that you need to know is that the igiobe might be given down from generation to generation. Do you understand? Therefore, the igiobe could be a property that was given by someone's father. Do you understand? That's the deceased father. Do you understand what I'm saying? However, this is not a must. Do you understand? But it could be an indicia. Do you understand? It could be like something you used to know. Oh, his father gave it to him, that one's father gave it to him, and all that and all that, and then you can trace it to this particular person. However, it is not a must that it must be given by the father. What should be a must is that the igiobe should have what is known as the ukure, which is the third thing. The igiobe must have the ukure. Now, the ukure is supposed to be the family shrine. So now, in the olden days, do you understand, what usually happens is people usually don't have a lot of houses. Do you understand? So they usually just have just one house and thereabouts. So according to the Benin custom, when a person dies, he is supposed to have two burials. Do you understand? Now, after the first burial has been done, the second burial is very, very important, because it is through the second burial that you are going to mount that person's altar in the house. And so, when you want to communicate to that person, or you want to communicate to the ancestors, then you go to the family ukure, and the family ukure is situated in the igiobe. So now, like I said earlier, you must have the ukure, which is supposed to be the family altar or the ancestral altar in the house. Do you understand? It was stated in the case of Arase versus Arase that the igiobe is the house where the deceased lived during his lifetime. It is not necessary that the deceased had died in that particular house. What is important is that the deceased lived in that particular house. Do you understand what I'm saying? Also, in the case of Ugbo versus Atsemota, the court held that the igiobe is the place where, or the house where, the deceased lived before his death. So in the case of Arase versus Arase, Ugbo versus Asemota, you also have the case of Idehe versus Idehe. Well, in these three cases, the court made this very clear that the deceased must live in that particular house during his lifetime. However, it is not necessary that the deceased had died in that particular house. Do you understand? But it is important that the deceased lived there. It is not important also that the deceased had received the particular house from his father. Do you understand? But what is important as well is that that particular house would have the family ancestral altar. Do you understand what I'm saying? So if the house has the family ancestral altar, which means that if that particular house would have where the deceased father was buried, then that house is likely to become the Igyubi. Do you understand what I'm saying? Now, because of modernity and the fact that people have started changing religions and we no longer practice our traditional African culture, most people are Christians, Muslims, or you know, all other traditions. People are beginning to do away with the ukure, which means having the family ancestral altar placed in their houses. So therefore, litigation and cases that goes to court nowadays usually would be asking the question, did the man live there or not? And no longer, is there the family altar there or not? Do you understand? In the olden days, people usually ask, was the family altar erected in that particular house? But now, people just ask, did the man live there during his lifetime or not? Do you understand? Now, the next question that people usually ask is whether two houses or more can constitute an Igyubi. Do you understand? Whether or not two houses or more would constitute Igyubi. Now, the very important case we need to look at is the case of Idehen versus Idehen. Now, in the case of Idehen versus Idehen, the court held in that case that two houses in that particular case constituted Igyubi, and it is only the eldest son that can inherit that particular property. So whether or not that property has been devised in a will to someone else, that would not apply, because according to Benin customary law, it is only the eldest son that can take the Igyubi. Then people started wondering that why would the Supreme Court say that two houses will be the Igyubi? However, it should be noted that there was no contention before the Supreme Court as to whether or not those two houses should be Igyubi. What was the contention before the court was whether the deceased can devise the Igyubi to a third party, that is to another person other than the eldest son. That was the contention before the court, and then the court had to hold that it is only the eldest son that can carry the Igyubi, and therefore, according to what was placed before the court, they already had it in mind that those two houses should be Igyubi. Therefore, if they do not argue before the court that one house should be Igyubi or thereabouts, the Supreme Court cannot start, you know, raising issues on behalf of the party. That is the reason the Supreme Court held that the two houses, which both parties agreed to be the Igyubi, would be the Igyubi to be inherited by the eldest son. You can see the case of Oke versus Oke, where they followed the principle laid down in the Idehen's case. The court held that the houses in a particular compound comprised of the Igyubi. Do you understand? Now, in the case of Agidigbi versus Agidigbi, now the court also held that so now, it is my submission that what will be regarded to be Igyubi would be determined by the fact of every case and how, you know, each party argues their case before the court, because it is the case that has been presented to the court that the court will give a judgment upon. Now, whether or not the Igyubi will be one or two or three or ten in a particular compound will be determined by the argument of the parties before the court. That means it will be determined by the pleadings of the parties before the court. But the Igyubi is meant to be just one particular house where you have the family altar. But like I said earlier, we no longer have the family altar because of modernity, but then one particular house where the deceased lived during his lifetime, as stated in the case of Arase and Arase, Idehen and Idehen and all that. So I hope that you now understand what the Igyubi is. Now, the next question that we are going to be answering, which is going to be in my next video, is who inherits the Igyubi and why? So if we are saying that the eldest son is to inherit the Igyubi, why should the eldest son inherit the Igyubi and all that? So make sure that you click the subscribe button and make sure that you click the like button. And if you have any question whatsoever to ask, please drop it in the comment section below and all that, so that we can have like an interaction. And please also make sure that you share the video. Thank you for watching. My name is Olayemi Diekolola Daniels. Zunga ngishilana Jehuza.